أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين وبه نستعين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، حبيب قلوبنا وطبيب نفوسنا، رحمة للعالمين، أبي القاسم محمد. والصلاة والسلام على أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين، ولعنة الله على أعدائهم أجمعين. اللهم كن لوليك الحجة ابن الحسن صلواتك عليه وعلى آبائه في هذه الساعة وفي كل ساعة، وليا وحافظا وقائدا وناصرا ودليلا وعينا، حتى تسكنه أرضك طوعا وتمتعه فيها طويلا برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آله. أما بعد، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. All praise and glory belongs to Allah, the creator of this universe, the one who has given all the tools necessary for a person to utilize these tools from matter and get the understanding of something which is non-matter. So when you look at the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He has given us, He has born us into this world that is made of matter, but He has given us the promise in which He is going to fulfill. If somebody was to utilize this world and gain that place where that being is going to live forever in the complete bliss, peace, and happiness. We as individuals, we are visual beings. He has created us as visual beings. He has given us those five senses, and we utilize these tools to acquire a perception which builds our reality. So therefore, when you look at people, they tend to have a bit of a difference in the opinions, is because one person might have built a perception that talks about another reality, and another person might have built a perception that talks about another reality. So what was necessary is to have these prophets, the representatives of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to come down, represent Him, and give the right perception so that everybody can be on one page, so that everybody can see the actual reality. So for that purpose, He has revealed the holy books. He has given the ability to the representatives of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to speak to the individuals according to their intellect and understanding. When I said that we are a visual being, if you remember kindergarten, not sure if you do, you remember it? Alhamdulillah. For you, because it's not been that long. For some of us, it's been a while. But in kindergarten, if you remember the way they taught you the language, they showed you a picture of apple, and they said that A is for apple. And they showed you a picture of book, and they said B is for book, right? So they associated the alphabets to pictures. And once we learned the alphabets, now what we can do is make words that will paint a picture in the mind of the other individual. So we use language to translate the reality or the perception that I have into words. And when you hear those words, there is a picture or reality that comes into your mind. Although the best communicators were Imam Masumin alayhi salam, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows human beings, what He has created, although you try your very best to let the other individual know of what picture you're seeing by utilizing the words. Right? So If you understand that, then you know that, you know, we have PowerPoint and we have all of these different tools by which you can do a presentation and let people know what you are saying, and they can probably comprehend a lot more than if it was just reading a book or text. Is that clear? Yes? So we know that there is a need for visual, for a human being to build a perception that becomes his or her reality. So part of those visuals we have in azab of Imam Hussain Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, that you all are wearing, for example, black clothes. So black clothes represents a picture with an emotion attached of sadness. Right? Just like that, in the azab you have the alam of Hazrat Abbas. The alam of Hazrat Abbas Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam represents who Hazrat Abbas was. Like when you look at the alam, all of a sudden, all of the things that you know about Hazrat Abbas alayhi salatu wasalam come to your mind. And if you just look at the alam, it's just, you know, it's just a cloth. You buy that from the market. But once you put Abbas on it, the association of this word with the cloth, now it doesn't remain the same cloth. Now you will not misuse this cloth. Instead, what you will do is you will show your reverence to this cloth. Right? You'll touch it. You'll kiss it. Right? And a lot of the times, you know, you end up getting these objections that why do we do that? Well, if we were not visual beings, then take all of the visual association out, and what are you left with? Right? If you take all of the visual that is associated to certain emotion, to certain pictures, or to certain perception, if you take that all out for human beings, what do you get? Nothing. A rose will not represent beauty anymore. The fragrance will not give you peace anymore. Right? All of it that we have is visual, and the intention of that individual even changes the metaphysical side of a thing. Just the intention. That when the person has intended that this cloth now is going to be represented, associated to Hazrat Abbas alayhi salatu wasalam, this cloth now changes into something else. If you wanted proof, there is experiments that have been done on the effect of intention. With me? Right? So, the experiments that they did was with random number generators. Okay, so they made a simple device that generates numbers. So, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, and it's all random. With these random number generators, they told the people to intend for zeros to be more. With me? For the zeros to be more than ones. Guess what happened in every experiment? The random number generators started to produce more zeros than one. An electronic device that would produce random numbers. Zeros and ones. What was the difference? The difference was the person intending that they wanted to see more zeros than one. The random generator, number generator, started making more zeros. And the scientists are baffled that how can this happen? Between this person and the random number generator, there is no connection. All the person is doing is intending. All they're doing is intending, and by intending, the numbers become more or less. When you do wudu, you intend to be purified. When you do wudu, you intend to be purified. That water changes. Now it's not the same water anymore. Just because you have intended for this to be a worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to gain nearness, now this water becomes holy. It becomes holy, and when you do vadu, you lose that impurity which was in your spirit. It's an amazing phenomenon. When you do your salah, when you bow down, that ruku is actually just a body movement. Right or no? If you were to say to somebody, you know, just stand there and do ruku and go in sijda, without that intention of gaining nearness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's nothing but aerobics. It's the exercise of the back or exercise of the body. But the person who's intending, now this is no longer just the exercise or the movement of the body, but it is a doorway. Now it becomes a doorway where a creation can connect to the Creator. That is just amazing. Right? They have done other experiments as well where, you know, a Korean scientist, he used water, and one person would say something good on the water and they would do a crystallization of this water and it would make beautiful patterns. And then on this water, somebody would say, utilize bad words, and then this crystallization of the water would change. It would become into these ugly patterns. But they have also done that with Quran recited on the water. You can go and check all of this out. They recited Quran on that water and the crystallization of the water was magnanimous. It was beautiful. You want more proof? A person decided that, you know, they had yogurt and they put electrical nodes in there to measure the electricity in that yogurt. Told the person sitting in front of the yogurt to talk about something good. As soon as the person was talking about something good, the yogurt showed electrical impulses in it. And when they told him to talk about something bad, the yogurt showed electrical impulses towards the negative side. And these are all experiments that have been done, and the scientists are baffled because this is non-local communication. There's no wires attached, there's no connection that seems to be there. But the matter is changing into something else. So when my brothers and sisters, you see the visuals that we have, the zari that we have, the alam that we have, right? When you see these visuals and people are showing reverence to it, don't think that there isn't any philosophy or logic or science or reasoning behind it. We have logic, we have reasoning, we have science, we have philosophy, we have purpose in every single action that has been given to us through the Imam Masumin or to the from the infallibles. And if I had the opportunity, I could go in a lot more detail. A lot more detail. And every single thing that we do, I could go in detail about that, but of course, our topic is not that. But I wanted you to know that. Even the minbar that I'm sitting on. Before it was just wood. It was just wood. But as soon as you put the black cloth, now it's a holy place. And you would say, no, it's not possible. It is. It becomes a portal now where غير masoom, but there are conditions though. The conditions are that you need to be sincere. You cannot speak out of fear or greed. You cannot speak here to project your knowledge. This is not a place for fankari, you know, where people show their skills of khatabat, moving the hands like this, like that. It's not a place to come and to be an actor. This is a place of worship, of reverence, of holiness, and you need to speak and give that message which is not tainted by our own lowly desires. And it has the quickest judgment. This minbar has the quickest judgment. Quickest judgment. In traditions, we find that underneath here, okay, behind in here, right now, it's just the problem is we don't have the eyes that could see. Right now, there is either heaven or hell. If I was to sit down here and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was to bless me and Imam Masumin alayhi salam was to bless me and I was to be connected to the Imam of the time, and the way that the message has been delivered, I was able to deliver it, by the time I get off of this minbar, my next step on the ground will be in heaven. It is that quick of a judgment. And if on here the person is utilizing this minbar as a tool for self-projection, or to their knowledge to be projected, or out of fear or greed, or to make money, or for any of those other purposes, the first step that this person takes off of this minbar is in the hellfire. It is that quick of a judgment. There could be two people who would walk through here, and one person would go out as a heavenly being and the other as a being of hellfire. And they both prayed namaz. They both prayed namaz, but between the two, one would be a heavenly person and the other would be a person of hellfire. Why? On their intention. إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ. On the intention, if one person prayed because they wanted to submit to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to glorify Him and to thank Him, that person is going out as a heavenly being. But if the other person intended to show off, so it's مَخَارِجُ وَالضَّالِّينَ. Just to show off their مَخَارِج, that person is walking out as a being of hellfire. They both perform the same action. One's intention was something else, and the other's was something else. Based on the intention, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them either heaven or hell. We forget about, when we talk about intention and we see that the Holy Prophet, the importance that is put on intention. Or Imam Masumin alayhi salam has put importance on intention. Or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put importance on intention, which is all of it is the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We don't realize how important it is. But when we understand that the intention can change the metaphysical side of a thing, or even the matter of a thing, we understand that all there is just intention. If you choose your intention to be pure, you're a heavenly being. If you choose your intention to be impure, you're a person of hellfire. It doesn't matter if you're a Maulana or not. It doesn't matter that. It matters on your intention. A person, you know, you come here, you have a lot of different, if you see, you know, garbage on the Farsh Aza, and you picked it up just so that, you know, it looks clean and nobody comes in and says, you know, these people don't have any respect for Imam Hussein, and you just threw it in the garbage. And it was out of sincerity. You would have more reward than a person coming and sitting here with impure intentions. Right? Allama Majlisi, may the peace and blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be upon him. A great scholar, don't have to introduce you to him. He was walking one day, and there was a Jewish woman with a baby, a toddler in her lap. And the toddler saw that Lama Majlisi had an apple in his hand. So he starts saying to the mother, I want this apple. And the mother says, you know, please be quiet. This is the Shaykhul Islam, and he's, you know, a high personality, and we're not Muslims. And don't keep on asking for this apple. Maybe he'll get upset. Lama Majlisi, the peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, saw that the child wanted this apple. So he went up to him and gave him the apple. Now, in one of his, you can say, dreams or a place where Urafa, or the people who get close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they get to see certain things, he saw himself to be in the Day of Judgment. And as things were being calculated, okay, what you did, what you did, what you did, he was given a certain stature in heaven. And then, when everything was calculated, something else was calculated that gave him a very big stature. Lama Majesty in that realm asked, what was that action that I had performed? And the angels told him that it was the apple that you gave to that Jewish child. Because that apple that you gave, there was a pure intention. There was no show off there. You didn't think of it as a big action. You just did it because the child was crying and you gave it to him. That's all. There was nothing else. So, my brothers and sisters, your intentions are words to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is the most precious than any of the actions that you're going to perform. If you can purify your intention and you choose to purify your intention, then every single thing that you will do will have a massive reward on the Day of Judgment. And we have to recognize that the azaa of Imam Hussain Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is a matter of the heart. Okay? It's a matter of the heart. Your tears, your hearts that break, it's a matter of the heart. It's not words. It's not speeches. It's a matter of your heart. If in your heart you're broken up, and the individuals who do come to the azaa of Imam Hussain Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, they need to be respected. Okay? They need to be respected. The respect of azair of Imam Hussain Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. They need to be respected because there is immense amount of respect for that individual. The reason is the association to Imam Hussain. The association to Imam Hussain. There was a student who was sitting down in the haram of Bibi Masuma, and a zaire came. He was in old clothes, you know. He wasn't like those people who do 5-star ziyarat. He wasn't one of those. He was a poor man who had traveled. And he was sitting down, and the student was sitting down, and he just dozed off and put his head on the shoulder of that student, Hausa student. And he fell asleep. And that Hausa student did not move from its place all night. In the morning, he got a little bit late because when the zaire woke up, he, you know, got up and went. His akhlaq teacher saw him and he said to him, what did you do last night? He said, I didn't do anything. He said, last night you did something that you are able to travel 200 years in one night. That what you would have done in 200 years, you accomplished that in one night. What did you do? All he did was respect the zaire of Bibi Masuma, that he does not get disturbed. No? Intention. More? Okay. If you were to have a fast on the Ghadir day, there is the reward of 70 years of worship. With me? Ghadir, the past. If you fasted on that day, you get 70 years of reward of worship. But if you were to go to someone's house and you don't tell them that you are with the fast, and the other individual offers you something sweet or something to eat, and to respect that individual, you were to have that, you would get twice the reward, meaning 70 times 2 is how much? 140 years worth of worship reward. Not that you go and you tell the person, no, I'm with fasting. No, not that. You don't do that. No, you just go and the person offers you, you have it to respect your mu'min brother. Look at the intention Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving for your intention. To respect your other mu'min brother, you were to open that fast, which is mustahab fast, you were to open it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will double the reward. 140 years of worship reward will be given to you. How do we calculate it reward? We calculate it like, okay, you know, I did one namaz, so I have this much, 10 times the sawab, I do, you know, I watch Bollywood, I have one guna. So in you tally, you got more deeds, good deeds, you got less bad deeds, so you're okay. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't judge us this way. He does not judge us this way. He looks at our intention and He gives us through that. So something might look, you know, it's not a very big deal, you know, I haven't done really too much, but look at the intention. If your intention was pure and you've chosen the right path, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward you immensely. Okay? So, all of the things, all of the symbols that we have that we need to show reverence and respect, there is a reasoning behind it. And just don't, you know, let go of them just because we haven't been able to explain to you. With me so far? What is the body language to show that you love something? What is the body language? You touch it and you kiss it. To show respect, what is the body language? You bow down. Right? It's a phenomenon everywhere. Why? Because it is in our nature. That it is through body language, it is through matter that we're able to get to the metaphysical and to the meaning and to something which is non-physical. Matam is the same. I told you about body language, right? 92% of our communication is through body language, 8% is verbal. How would, when if you were to come and see somebody going like this, what body language is this person telling you? Come on. No, but they're just going like this. What are they telling you? Yeah. They're like, their emotions are not that intense. Their sadness is not that intense, although they might be in a place of respect, but that grief is not that much. It is respect. You have your hand on your chest. It's a common sign. It's everywhere. You have this. It's a sign of respect. But if somebody was to go like this, what is that? Now, what is your body saying? That your grief is too much. That your grief is too much. You are expressing your grief through your body language, communicating to somebody who does not know that you are grieving. When that person sees you that way, the person comes up and asks you, what is wrong with you? Why are you doing that? And then you have the opportunity to tell that individual, I'm grieving. And the reason why I'm grieving is that 1400 or more years ago, there was a being that was not, that his stature was such that what happened to him was not according to his stature. I met a person who was in prison. And he was attending one of the majlises. After the majlis, I looked at him, I spoke to him. And he told me, he said, I was in prison and somebody told me the story of Hazrat Ali Asghar. And he said that I was a hardcore criminal. But when I heard that story, he said, I cried like I did not cry ever in my life. I cried like I have never cried in my life. And after that, I started looking in the reason why would somebody slaughter a 6 month baby this way. He said, the question came to my mind that why would this do happen? What were these individuals who committed that kind of atrocity? And then he said, the other question came to my mind was that the father that sacrificed the 6 months baby, why did he go through that pain? And he said, when I started to ask these questions, I found Islam and I became a Muslim. And after becoming a Muslim, I became a Shia. And since then, I'm a Shia. Sometimes people ask us the question, what is the purpose of this azada you're doing? The purpose of the azah is to get those individuals that have, they have no idea what has happened 1400 years ago, for them to realize. And by realizing, there are many people who find the path of Imam Hussein. And by finding the path, they find the guidance. By finding the guidance, they get onto that straight path that will lead them to the hereafter, towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where they can find the bliss and happiness forever. If somebody is doing matam with a lot of big hands and coming down as to show somebody else that how hard I can hit my chest, then that matam is not going to have any effect. Your emotions are there. You are there to project your emotions through that matam of yours. It's not a competition. It is there to show that your heart is broken. You are there because you want to tell others that this is what has happened. So can we make our juluses better? Yes, we can. Are there things that we are doing that needs to be corrected? Definitely. Do we have to utilize some sort of means of communication to get this message across? Definitely. But can we stop this? No. Can we improve on our azah of Imam Hussein? Yes. Can we become better in the way that we do the azah of Imam Hussein Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? Yes. But because of all of the differences, all of the problems that we have for the azah of Imam Hussein Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, we cannot discontinue it. We cannot say that no, we're not going to have matam, or no, we're not going to have the marsiyah, or no, we're not going to have the Noah, or we're not going to have the Alam, or we're not going to take out the Dhari, or we are not going to feed people when they come, or we're not going to do this, or we're not... No! All of this needs to happen. I'll tell you a quote of someone that when was asked, where did you get everything? He said, Muhammad is Dari, mas Karbala Dari. So whatever that we have is from Karbala. He said that I want to kiss the hands of those people who do matam, and their young people who do matam, whose hands by doing matam become red. He said, I would love to kiss them. I would love to kiss them. Ayatollah Projerdi, rahmatullah alayh, he was the marja'i taqlid for the whole world. One time he had pain in his eyes, he went to the doctor, and doctors could not do anything for him. It was the day of Ashur, which is coming. It was the day of Ashur. There were young men who were doing matam, and in their culture they put dirt on their foreheads. He said that they came and they were doing matam, and something came to my mind to go and take the dirt from the foreheads of these young people and put it in my eyes. With me? To take the dirt that was on the forehead of these young men to put it in his eyes. He said, I did that. And after that, I never had pain in my eyes. For the rest of my life, I never had pain in my eyes, or I needed glasses. I don't know more. Ayatollah Bahjat, rahmatullah, one of the scholars who was very, very close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in his last will he says, take the dirt of the feet of the Zairin of Imam Hussein. Like the dirt you have here. Take the dirt of the Zairin of Imam Hussein, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and when I pass away, on my coffin, sprinkle that. That I may be saved. When you associate something to Imam Hussein, the level and the degree of holiness of that thing is unimaginable. Unimaginable. And what we are doing is, our youth are becoming far away from the azah of Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam, because They think that this is just a tradition. Yes, a lot of these things that we do is part of our tradition. But these traditions have meaning behind. We fail to tell you what those meanings were. We fail to tell you what those meanings were, but if you were to listen, you would realize that all of these traditions that we have, with the exceptions of a few, they all have a meaning and purpose, and there is a reason behind it. If there is a tradition that does not coincide with the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we need to let go of that. But if it doesn't, we can keep it. I want to give you an example. Have you guys made ever cookies? You know the cookie cutter? What you do, you have the dough, you put the cookie cutter, whatever is left, whatever is inside, you take, whatever isn't, you don't. Islam is that cookie cutter. It is those boundaries that you can put on top of any culture, anything, whatever comes inside, take it. Whatever is not inside, leave it. You can live anywhere in the world. Just take that cookie cutter and put it on top of that culture. Whatever comes inside, take it. Whatever doesn't, take it. The importance of all of these days, the reason why I decided to change a little bit, is because Ashur day is coming, and your hearts need to be ready for that day. It's not far away anymore. It's not far away. Your hearts need to be ready. If your hearts are not ready for that day, it'll come and go. There are people who will come on the minbar, and on the 8th or the 9th, there was individuals in a particular city who said, "I'm not going to read the Masaib of Imam Hussain." Say, why? Say, "Oh, because you don't cry for Allah, therefore I'm not going to read the Masaib of Imam Hussain." Say, "Yani what? What kind of logic is that? Because you don't cry in namaz for Allah, you don't cry in dua, I'm not going to read the Masaib of Imam Hussain." Crying in the Masaib of Imam Hussain is association of Imam Hussain to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A young man, the Holy Prophet saw him. The Holy Prophet said to that young man, "Do you love me?" He said, "I love you." He said, "Do you love me more than your parents?" He said, "I love you more than my parents." He said, "Do you love me more than your brothers?" He said, "I love you more than my brothers." He said, "Do you love me more than your life?" The young man said, he was not baligh. The young man said, "I love you more than my life. I swear to Allah." Then the Holy Prophet said, "Do you love me more than Allah?" And the young man paused. He said, "Ya Rasulullah, the reason why I love you more than my parents, the reason why I love you more than my brothers, the reason why I love you more than my own life is because of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That you are Rasulullah. You are Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's Rasul. You are His Prophet. Your association is to Allah. Imam Hussain al-Sadduzam is a Hujjatullah. He's the representative, the proof of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My brothers and sisters who are dementing your ideology, crying for Imam Hussain, associated to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is worship. It's not a custom. Yes, if you disassociate Imam Hussain from Allah, then there is a problem. But how can you? When the Prophet said, "Hussain minni wa ana min Hussain." Hussain is from me and I am from him. How can you? But for our youths, you don't cry anymore. You don't know how to cry anymore. Because you've seen so much gore. You've seen bodies fly. You've seen heads being blown off. You've seen legs been cut off, arms been cut off in your games and in your movies. You don't cry anymore. Your hearts have become hardened. And unfortunately, we don't feel the love of the uncle, of the cousin, of the grandfather, of the sister, of the brother. These relationships that we used to have,
Then when somebody said cha-cha, we would have this love of, we would know what the love of cha-cha is. Or said mamu, we would know the love of our mamu. And we could associate that love on the lowest level of connection with Imam Hussein. On the lowest level. That, you know, if I was to see the severed head of my uncle on a spear, what would be my emotions? And all of this love that we had for our uncle would translate into these tears that was of association. And then we would think that this was not just a regular uncle. This was someone who was the embodiment of loyalty. This was someone who was the slave of Allah. This was someone who took Imam Hussein, the Imam of the time, as his master. He was someone who was there, who sacrificed himself for the love of Allah. We start from that bottom and we go high. We don't cry anymore. Our hearts don't break. Our hearts don't move. Our hearts need to move. Just imagine in your own heart, in your mind. Hazrat Ali Akbar. You know, Imam Hussein prepared him for the battle. Can you imagine your father preparing you to go face thousands of these enemies? You know how mothers prepare children to go to school or to get out of the house? The Bibis came and prepared Hazrat Ali Akbar. Hazrat Ali Akbar looked as a photocopy of the Prophet. When Imam Hussein said, you know, he's having him go. Hazrat Ali Akbar was going, and he would go a little bit, and he would turn around. You know what he would see? He would see Imam Hussein following him. Can you imagine the heart of Hazrat Ali Akbar at that time? Can you feel the emotion? Imam Hussein was following Hazrat Ali Akbar. He would stop a little bit, look back, and what he would see is Hussein. Why was Imam Hussein doing that? Just for another little while, let me see that face. Just for a little bit longer, let me see this face. This face that reminds me of my grandfather. That his manners are like my grandfather. In his speech, he is like my grandfather. Imam Hussein kept on saying that this nation that is killing the son of mine. Hazrat Ali Akbar goes to the battlefield, and his fighting was amazing. He fought. Whoever would come would be defeated. And he would say to people, that, do you know who I am? They would tell him, do you know who I am? I am the son of Hussein, and Hussein is the son of Ali. So, do you know who I am? And they would fight with him, and they would get defeated. And the thirst of Hazrat Ali Akbar, you look at the traditions of the Maqatil of Karbala, Hazrat Ali Akbar came 3 times back to his father saying, Father, I'm really thirsty. I don't know if you can imagine the thirst of Hazrat Ali Akbar when you are fasted and after when you open your fast. Remember that thirst? Then if you were not given water that time, and then 3 days go by. 3 days go by, could you imagine how your throat would be? Can you imagine what would be the state of the thirst of, he would say, Al-Atash, ya. The thirst is killing me. Hazrat Ali Akbar would say, this thirst is going to kill me. Hazrat Ali Akbar used to come, and this was the opportunity again. I will see my father again. I'll get to see him again. Goes back. The enemy could not take, they could not take over Hazrat Ali Akbar. You know what they did? Can you hear it? You know it. You know what they did? Can you imagine it? A person from the back took a spear. He hid. He took a spear and lodged it in the back of Hazrat Ali Akbar. This spear came out from his chest. Hazrat Ali Akbar, at this time, says, As-salamu alayka ya Aba Abdullah. This is my last salam. When he fell, in the traditions it says that the narrator narrates that a woman came out of the tents. And she ran quickly. And she was there on the body of Ali Akbar before Hussein could reach. And the narrator says, I asked, who is this woman? And the other person says, this is Zainab. This is the daughter of Ali. You know, the neighbors of Imam Ali did not know that Bibi Zainab, that Imam Ali had a daughter named Zainab. Because nobody ever saw Bibi Zainab. Nobody ever saw Bibi Zainab. But the day that people started to see Zainab, Imam Hussein comes and says to Bibi Zainab, please go back to the tent. Have patience. Now at this point, I don't know if it can be recited, but if you can imagine an old man who has a young son, he's looking at his chest and there is a piece of spear sticking out of it. And this young son of his, when Fel had told him that, Baba, you were right when you told me that the grandfather of ours would be giving me that drink, that after that I will never get thirsty. And that he said, Baba, for you the drink is also ready. Come soon. This old father takes his hand on that piece of the spear. I don't know if his heart is still not moved. This old man, this old father, has to pull that spear out of the chest. Can you imagine the strength that is required? Can you imagine how that spear came out of the chest of Ali Akbar? And now is the task to take the body of Hazrat Ali Akbar to the tents. This is so difficult. You know, Imam Hussein, the way he picked up Hazrat Ali Akbar, he put his back to the back of Ali Akbar. He put his back to the back of Ali Akbar. He put his arms into the arms of Ali Akbar. Now, he couldn't lift Hazrat Abbas. The arms were gone. And when Hazrat Abbas had fallen, there were no arms, he fell on his face. Here's Hazrat Ali Akbar, he puts his back to the back of Hazrat Ali Akbar, he sits him down, he puts his back to the back of Hazrat Ali Akbar, he puts his arms into the arms of Hazrat Ali Akbar, and he tries to move this body. So that the tent, when the women are looking, when the children are looking, they should see the face of Hussein, not Ali Akbar. They would not have the strength to see the face or the chest of Ali Akbar. Imam Hussain is going in the feet of Hazrat Ali Akbar and making the signs in the sand of Karbala that this young boy, this young man is being dragged by this old father. Oh Allah, through your mercy, through your grace, through the chest of Ali Akbar, that broken chest, oh Allah, we beseech you, we ask you, we ask you, we want you to move our hearts, we want you to show us what is the right path, we want you to tell us the holiness of these beings. We want to know, we want to love. For their sake, we are sinful. We have sins, we have made mistakes. Please, for the sake of Bibi Zainab, for the sake of Hazrat Ali Akbar, for the sake of Imam Hussain, purify our hearts, forgive our sins. Give us the opportunity to be with the Imam of the time, for us to be his followers. And curse the enemies of Ahlul Bayt. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim wa al-Asr. Inna al-insana lafi khusr illa alladhina amanu wa amilu salihat wa tawassu bil haqq wa tawassu bil sabr.